The big debate of the day. In the last 12 to 18 hours, there has been tight security, Z category security that has been provided to our External Affairs Minister S. Jaishankar. The reason that has been done is that in Surrey, where there are Khalistani sympathizers, Khalistani organizations that have been planted, that have been embedded, and there has been this posters and hoardings of death threats that have been issued to External Affairs Minister S. Jaishankar. Visuals on your screens, in fact, of these hoardings, where Prime Minister Narendra Modi and S. Jaishankar's images have been put out on this hoarding. This has been done by the Khalistani forces, by the Khalistani terrorist organization that is behind it, and therefore an immediate stringent action that has had to be taken by the Indian government. I'm surprised and a little shocked to know that at this point of time, why has the Canadian Prime Minister Justin Trudeau not come out with a statement? Meanwhile, there is another big development that has taken place. This is with regards to the parity in number of diplomats as well as their ranks that India has continued to demand for to happen from the Canadian side has still not been done. So there are, out of the 61 of the Canadian diplomats, a handful of them had been sent to Singapore and Malaysia. The other ones continue to stay put in India. Now, India has been decent and courteous enough to not rake up this matter, but that should not allow for the Canadian diplomats and the Canadian government to take advantage of our hospitality and our niceness. I'm going to start off this conversation. There are two aspects of this debate and we'll take them one by one. On the telecast with me, Professor Madhav Nalapat, the one more sinister development that has taken place, extremely concerning, is that the Prime Minister Narendra Modi's picture and that of our External Affairs Minister's picture has come up on a hoarding in Surrey in British Columbia. There are death threats that have been issued to both our Prime Minister and our External Affairs Minister. What is the Canadian government and Justin Trudeau doing?
The answer is nothing. The fact is that British Columbia has become a safe haven for agents of the Chinese Communist Party and basically their allies, GHQ Rawalpindi. For both these forces and all their activities, frankly, throughout the world, including to some extent in Canada itself, some parts of Canada are now a very safe zone where no action is taken against such individuals. The fact that the head of state of a fellow Commonwealth country, the head of state of a fellow G20 member country, in fact, a country which is now having the presidency of G20, and the head of government and the external affairs minister of that government, if the open death threats are being given to them, posters are being distributed, surely it will be obvious to Canadian police who printed these posters. Surely it would be obvious who is responsible for funding this kind of posters, and yet no action has been taken.
Yeah.
So I'm sorry to say, Canada is becoming a safe haven for those in, basically the Sino-Pakistan lobby in all their activities against India, whether violent or otherwise.
Yeah. Professor Nalapat, we understand, how sinister and serious this death threat issued by the Khalistanis is. We have already experienced one of our prime ministers who was assassinated by these Khalistanis, by this terrorist organization and their terror tentacles that had spread in India, particularly in the 1980s. Why isn't the Canadian government taking this seriously?
Look, the fact is that there are elements in the Canadian government who are in close contact with two countries that are neighbors of India, with the sympathizers, I'm not going to call them agents, known sympathizers of two countries that are hostile to India, that have gone to war with India. It is well known that there are safe zones in Canada for, certainly for the CCP, the Chinese Communist Party, very, very safe zones. And there are safe zones, therefore, for the CCP's friends, including in GHQ Rawalpindi and all the various auxiliary groups of GHQ Rawalpindi. Megha, let me point out to you, there have probably been more demonstrations in Canada, in cities in Canada, in support of Hamas, including the Hamas terror attack on Israel than there have been in Gaza itself. And this indicates the tolerance level, the incredible level of tolerance of the Justin Trudeau government towards all forms of terrorism. When you have people who are openly celebrating the killing of innocent Israeli children and men and women, people who are openly calling for the killing of Indians, who have been responsible for the killing of Indians, all this is going on in a country that calls itself bound by the rule of law and the international law order. Yeah. I want to say it's international disorder and ruled by outlaw.
Okay, all right. Savio, you know, again, the question, it has, you know, 24 hours have elapsed since this hoarding came up. There have been protests that have been raised by India. There has been action that has been taken by giving Z security to our external affairs minister. Why no reaction from the Canadian government? Why has that hoarding still not been taken down?
That China right now under the leadership of, Canada right now under the leadership of Justin Trudeau is nothing but a puppet of China and of Pakistan and various other political nations that want to work against the interest of India. Now, why do I say that and why do I make such a strong statement? I make that statement primarily because if you look at what is happening in Canada over the last couple of months, including a year, actually, you can go way back till about a year, you would realize that certain anti-national elements, anti-human elements, people who want to spread fear, terrorism, and anti-social activities have been taking refuge in Canada. And that is why you see this huge surge of the Khalistani movement happening in Canada. And Khalistani movement in its focus on India is always negative. They do not want to be a part of the Indian system. They want to create a system of their own. They are aggressive. They are antisocial in nature and they're very anti-national in nature. And therefore, giving any room to Khalistanis in Canada is working against the interest of India. And Justin Trudeau has made that very clear in his communication, in the allegations that he leveled on India as far as the death of that particular Khalistani terrorist that was there. And I call them terrorists because to me, whether you're Khalistani, whether you're Hamas, or whether you're LET, if your idea is to spread terror, then you are not a militant, you are a terrorist, and that's really what you are.
Yeah.
So today, you know, I think one of the most important things for us as people that come from India who look at humanitarian ethos more than anything else, when you look at the support some people have been giving to Hamas, a terror organization, after the brutal attack that they did on Israel, you realize that sometimes the political area is so dark. India hatred for India, India hatred for Israel, and more important, India hatred for humanity. People are actually justifying the killing and the rape of innocent people, including babies, and trying to find reasons saying that, you know, it was not 40 babies who were decapitated, whose heads were decapitated, but maybe there were few. But the end result is that you killed a child.
Yeah.
You killed babies. And that's horrific because Hamas basically does not represent Palestine. There might be Palestinians supporting Hamas, but they don't represent Palestine. Mm-hmm. They are there because they are a terror organization. They have decided to do it at this point of time to derail the peace process that Israel was having with Saudi Arabia, United Arab Emirates, various other Arab nations. They want to ensure that the Abraham Accords is defeated.
Coming back to particularly this matter between Canada and India, and has been quite the strife between both the nations, and in particular, quickly about, you know, these two points are connected. Here it is. Our Prime Minister and our External Affairs Minister is being threatened. There are death threats that are being issued. There is a hoarding to prove that. The last time around, it took, I think, more than a couple of weeks for the Canadian government and the Canadian police to take notice of these hoardings that had come up in Surrey, in British Columbia, that were targeting our Indian ambassadors and diplomats, issuing same kind of death threats to them as well. It was finally removed. It was finally, action was taken a little late. It was quite delayed. And in the same breath, India is not taking it sitting down. India demands that these diplomats be removed from the soil of India. Now, if the Canadians are not doing this, what does this mean?
Well, first of all, you know, once the Canadians are not taking away the diplomats, you know, I think at any point of time, the Indian government holds the authority and the right to take off their diplomatic immunity. That is one thing. So then they become normal citizens, and they can be prosecuted also if any kind of evidence is found from them for any kind of wrongdoing. So I think Canada is trying to deliberately provoke, and whether Canada is doing it alone or whether there are other elements working in tandem with Canada, that we have to see. But at the same time, there is a very interesting, you know, issue that happened yesterday. Not very interesting, but you know, normal thing we can say. There was a meeting of the NATO defense ministers in Brussels, and Bill Blair, the defense minister of Canada, was shown the gruesome pictures of what Hamas did to Israeli kids and others during that horrific incident of horrific attack rather on October 8th. So tell me, Megha, we have literally zero expectation from Canadian government. But what is the stand of other G7 members who are allies of Canada, who consider India as a strategic partner? What is the stand of the G7 countries? Mm. Have you seen any of the G7 countries coming up and telling to the Canadian government that you cannot have hoardings like this against a country's prime minister and external affairs minister?
You cannot have hoardings. There has been precedent that has been set by these Khalistanis Patikrit. One of our prime ministers back in the day, 1984, was assassinated. I mean, well, you have proof in the pudding.
Absolutely. And so the risk becomes even more profound. Then comes another issue, which we have already discussed in the past, that do the Americans or the other G7 members, and leave alone Canada, consider or equate the Kanishka bombing and the 9/11 on the same level? No, that they don't do that. That's where the problem is. The hypocrisy of the Canadian government is that they went to fight America's war on terror in Afghanistan, but did not give justice to more than 250 Canadians who were killed in the same Kanishka flight, you know, which was done, and which was actually, you know, the entire mastermind of it, or the planning was done from Canada itself. So there is a huge double standard. That's why I think that I don't think Canada is working alone in it.
Yeah.
Yes, there are names of China and Pakistan which comes up, which are very much possible. But China and Pakistan are our known adversaries in some or the other way. But the question is it only they doing it, or there are also other players who are apparently on the face of it, our partners and strategic partners? But, you know, they don't mind if these things come up in Canada. I have not seen any of the G7 members coming up and saying they are opposed to it. So okay, Here is a country called Canada, which would, you know, I think officially as part of NATO, they have to condemn what happened in Israel. So they would be condemning Hamas.
Okay.
So they condemn Hamas, okay, but they do not condemn Khalistanis at all.
So,
and that's the issue with the whole of
the hypocrisy,
West,
the double standards that are very, very visible. A comment from you here as well. Like I said, a former prime minister of our country, Indira Gandhi, was assassinated by Bhindranwale, by the Khalistani terrorist here in New Delhi. This happened in 1984. Is the Canadian government overlooking, ignoring it, or like Patikrit said, you know, they are by design not taking action on this? There was just a few weeks ago, there was this tableau that was taken out on the streets of Canada in Surrey, where there was a demonstration of how there was celebration of Talvinder Singh Pannu, there was celebration of the Khalistanis who had killed Indira Gandhi, and there are memorials that are set up in various parts of Canada, in British Columbia particularly, where the likes of the perpetrators of the Air India 1985 attack, the bombing, are celebrated. They are called martyrs. There are tributes being paid to them openly.
Thanks for having me, Megha. You know, it is very evident that, you know, there are certain elements, or rather certain antisocial elements, which are harbored in the West, and they enjoy quite a degree of immunity, whether it be in the United Kingdom, Canada, Australia, and even United States. The West, you know, always comes out loud championing the cause of human rights and democracy, but it very conveniently sort of turns a very blind eye to, you know, terrorists of other nations. And this is just not of India, right? So there are, there is the Bangladeshi Noor Chaudhary, who's been accused of staging genocide of even 12-year-old boys in Bangladesh, who's got refuge in Canada. There are LTTE members who have found refuge in Canada, and apparently they had a you know, brilliant structure in place with regards to intelligence sharing and funding channel setup. So all of that, you know, the West seems to categorize terrorists as good terrorists and bad terrorists, and that is all as per the geopolitical interests and narrative that tends to suit them. You know, it's shocking that, you know, in the grand scheme of things, they have flouted the fundamentals of the Vienna Convention. The Vienna Convention articulates very clearly that diplomatic agents should be provided with the appropriate security, and their dignity must be upheld by the host nation. Not only United Kingdom, but Canada, you know, repeatedly has flouted that by allowing, you know, these nefarious actors to, you know, put up posters of our High Commissioner or the External Affairs Minister or the Prime Minister, and basically in the garb of freedom of speech, calling for murders or calling for, you know, harm to them. You know, it's the fact that they are not taking this into account, the fact that they are still hiding behind the garb of freedom of speech, completely exposes their duplicity and their hypocrisy.
You know, but Professor Nalapath, I mean, why is the world not enraged? And like Patrikrit said, that there are double standards that are being witnessed when it comes to fighting the war against Ukraine, when it comes to fighting the war and supporting Israel, and when it comes to the Canadians who are hell-bent and on calling these Khalistani terrorists as people who are wanting freedom, people who are demanding freedom, people who want a separate state of Khalistan. I want to drill this point again and again, that there is a death threat that has been issued against our Prime Minister and against our External Affairs Minister. Why does Canada continue to take this leniently? Why is the West now engulfed in what is happening in Israel, and therefore they're not paying attention?
No, I don't think that, you know, we can talk about the West being involved and not paying attention. I do believe that they have been talking to the Canadians quite forcefully, and Justin Trudeau, frankly, has got a very, very lukewarm reaction to the many hysterical rants that he has given. He finally gave up on talking to countries in Europe, and then he started switching to countries in the Middle East. There also he got a cold shoulder. But the fact is, Megha, that there are places in Canada where openly it is planned how to commit terror attacks in India. These are openly discussed. Messages are exchanged, money is exchanged. So in other words, plotting and planning conspiracies for these kind of atrocities that are designed to happen in India take place in Canada. Do you know that last Saturday, October 7th, when this brutal terror attack took place on Israel, you know what happened? There were parties in Canada. There were celebrations in Canada in some houses. I'm sure the Canadian authorities know which houses were there, where there were parties and celebrations at the death of, decapitation of babies, at the brutalization of women, at the killing of old and young people. They know where these parties took place. They know where these celebrations took place, and yet no action is taken. Now, why the other NATO member countries, why the other G7 countries are keeping mum about it, I can't answer that. Okay. Except to say, quite frankly, it's a, as has correctly been said, it's a very clear double standard. But what I want to say, Canada is becoming a source of risk and danger to democracies all over the world because of the terrific influence of the Sino-Wahhabi lobby in Canada, and in particular, the Sino-Pakistan lobby.
Okay, all right. Savio, again, you know, the point that is India taking it sitting down? Is our response tapered? Whether it is about, I don't know, so far I've not seen a statement that has been released by the MEA or any of the ministers or External Affairs Minister S. Jaishankar coming out and making a statement himself. Similarly, when it comes to us demanding parity of diplomats in number and in rank, there has just been a statement in this regard that has been reiterated by the MEA yesterday. No forceful communication or statements being brought in.
Is this for Savio or me?
Savio, Megha? This is for Savio. Savio, can you hear me? Or I think, I don't know, there's a freeze frame. So I'll come back to Savio. But Patrik, are we taking it sitting? Are we more, should we be more aggressive?
Well, I think Megha, I think Canada will continue to provoke us. And you know, there is a situation which is happening in Middle East today. It's a situation about which every country is worried, and India also has its own issues to deal with it. So if we try to undermine what's happening, you know, on the Canadian front, the Canadians will continue to provoke us. So they will try that we take some action. So just as I said, that the diplomatic immunity can be taken off. Something more can be done by India in terms of completely calling off diplomatic relation. So they want us to act, and then they will say, look, this is what India has done. So this is the ploy, and I'm sure the government of India, the PMO and the MEA understands what the Canadians are trying to do. As and when the necessity arises, India would take action. But it also vindicates time and again, Megha, that when it comes to dealing with terrorism, please do not depend on the West. And I'm sure India is not depending because the US has its own interest to deal with.
Okay.
You know, the Chinese angle definitely comes in. We cannot deny or discount that either. But when it comes to the issue of terrorism, unfortunately, whatever hits the West is defined as terrorism. The rest doesn't matter beyond a point. But what they don't understand is that, you know, it is not necessary that the next 9/11, God forbid, it should not happen. It's not necessary that it would be done by the next Al-Qaeda. And there is no guarantee that tomorrow an organization like Hamas would not join hands with organizations, which are inimical to India, or organizations based in Canada, you know, having the Khalistani flag. You cannot rule out. That is the problem when you actually give a playing ground to the dangerous elements.
Okay.
It is like the snakes in the backyard. It can bite you also. Yeah, the West should be careful about it.
Yes. A perception being created that Canada has become the Pakistan of the West. And I don't think one can refute that, keeping in mind safe havens being given to terrorists in the name of them being called, I don't know, are they calling them freedom fighters? Are they calling them persons who have freedom to speak their mind, freedom of speech, freedom of expression? Under the garb of all these cliched statements, these are terror havens that have been created in Canada, basically.
The parallels that you draw between Pakistan and Canada, I think, are very apt. What Pakistan is to terrorism, Canada has now become that safe haven for sort of organized crime. If we were to look at it, the kind of organized crime that is taking place in Canada with regards to, you know, drug cartels operating, you know, they essentially funding the SFJ, they funding, political outfits, people from within those cartels essentially having, tentacles deep within the Canadian intelligence services and the polity. So all of this is a clear nexus, and it proves that, Canada is going the Pakistan route. In fact, you know what, Cameron McKay this year has become the highest summoned foreign ambassador in South Bloc, taking over the Pakistani. So, you know, that in itself gives us a testimony that, you know, which way Canada is essentially going towards.
Absolutely. I thank all of you for joining me on the telecast. We'll keep a close eye on all these big developments, because big developments are happening. We have tried our level best to reason with Canada and Justin Trudeau. That is clearly not happening. And it is soon going to be time for India to take stern actions. On that note, I slip into a short break. Thanks for watching.
For more such videos, subscribe to the NewsX YouTube channel, hit the bell icon.